Well, how many of you were singing on that? I'll tell you what, you every one of you better have been. If you wasn't singing with your lips, you better have been singing in your heart. Because you see, his death is not our victory. His crucifixion is not our victory. It's the resurrection. If everything happens but the resurrection, we're still lost. He arose. Hallelujah. Christ arose. Take your Bible to Matthew, the 28th chapter. We're going to read our text in two parts. We're going to read verse 1 to begin with. When we get to the last point of this journey that we're on this morning, we'll read verses 2 through verse 6. It would have been quite interesting to have been present and been allowed to participate in that first Easter sunrise service so many years ago. The Bible tells us that there weren't very many in attendance. Fact is, the Bible tells us, Matthew tells us of three. He tells us that Mary Magdalene was there, and that's the one whom Christ had cast seven evil spirits out of. He said the other Mary was there. Now, Luke identifies her as the mother of James. And then Matthew also says that there was an angel of the Lord present. Well, if you move over into the Gospel of Mark, Mark adds a name to that, and it's the name of Salome, S-A-L-O-M with an E on it. And then Luke tells us a little bit later, he just says that doesn't name the others, but he says there were certain others that were present at this first Easter service. Now, what I want to draw from today is this. How many of you have ever heard the name S.M. Lockridge? Very many, a few of you have. S.M. Lockridge is an old black brother, an old black pastor. And he preached a sermon one time, and I'm using a part of it for our title today, but it was simply called It's Friday, But Sunday's Coming. And in fact, if you have access to the internet this afternoon sometime when you go home, don't do it on your phone during church, but we need to cut internet access out in this worship center, I guess, during church. But when you go home, just Google or go to YouTube and do S.M. Lockridge, It's Friday, But Sunday's Coming. And it's on there in many different ways. The whole sermon's on there. It's an hour plus to listen to that. But just this part of his message, It's Friday, But Sunday's Coming. It's been on there, and it's been done in a lot of ways. Well, what I want us to look at this morning, and I say that to tell you that I'm using a part of the title of his message for our message today, simply Sunday's Coming. What I want us to do this morning is this, there's a part of verse 1, and we'll read it in its entirety in a moment, but the Bible tells us that we identify Mary and then the other Mary, and then it just says in verse 1 that they came to the tomb. So what I want us to do for the first 90% of this message is I want us to relive what these ladies must have been talking about, thinking about, or experiencing as they made this journey from whatever home was to them to go to the tomb where Jesus lay. Now, what I believe that was, if whether it was the topic of conversation or whether it was just what was on their hearts and in their minds, what I believe it were the events of Friday. And we've all experienced things in our life where when that experience was over, that we would go home and we would lay down and we would close our eyes. And every time that we would close our eyes, we would see the traumatic event of whatever it was that we just lived through. Well, I believe for these who were making their way to the tomb of Jesus to perform proper burial on him, I believe that what was emblazoned, written, seared into their hearts and into their minds were the events of Friday. And as they made this journey this Sunday morning, as Scripture gives it to us, they could still hear the sounds. They could still smell the scents. They could experience all the different things that they experienced in person maybe on Friday. Those things were so real to them that I believe that they were reliving those things on this Sunday morning. What I want us to do this morning is I want us to take what could have been the same journey that they were taking, whether it was by conversation or whether it was just in their minds. I want us to take that same journey and relive the events of Friday. Now, I want you to understand before we will even begin today that as this story goes, it's not Friday anymore for us. We all know that, and I don't mean it's just Sunday because our calendar today says we live on the Sunday side of the cross. We don't live on the Friday side anymore. But we need to always remember what happened on the Friday side. We never need to forget. So stand, let's read this one verse of Scripture. We won't stand later, but I'll finish the text out later on in the message. But that verse 1 just simply says this: Now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. You can be seated. What did they relive as they made this journey on this particular day? I think the first thing that they relived, and these are listed on your outline. If you have a bulletin, you can sort of fill them out and you can kind of see where we are on this journey. But the first place is the Garden of Gethsemane. That's the first, and the scriptures that will appear under these on all the points of the outline, there you can write them. I didn't list them in the bulletin, but you can jot those down, and these are the places in Scripture that you can go back to and you can read the events that have to do with the Garden of Gethsemane. So that's what all of those scriptures will mean, and we won't read them through the course of the message. We'll just allude to some. Now, the Garden of Gethsemane is our first stop. It's somewhere shortly after midnight, early on Friday morning, and inside the walls of the city of Jerusalem, the city had began to spring back to life and activity. People began to stir because during the Passover season, it was very common for people to get by on the very minimal amount of sleep that they could because they wanted to savor the Passover events and the Passover season. Well, not very far outside the walls of the city of Jerusalem, there's this green grove of olive trees, and they surround a garden, and this is that garden. It's a garden that's called the Garden of Gethsemane, and it's inside that garden, inside that grove of olive trees that Jesus would oftentimes visit. Well, it's there that we first see the figure of Jesus, and the Bible tells us that we get a picture of a man lying prostrate on the rocks, and he's sweating, the Bible tells us, great drops of blood. And we know that man is none other than Jesus Christ. And it's at this point in this juncture in Scripture that his final great passion begins. So what happens, and I'm going to read you verses out of the various gospel events of these things, so it will be hard to follow me from book to book and all of those things, but we're going to tell the story by putting all of the gospel stories and accounts together this morning as best I can. This is our Savior's greatest time of need. This is when he comes and in fact he speaks to his friends. And Mark gives us this verse in Mark 14 and the 34th verse. Jesus speaks and he says, "My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death." And then Jesus said to his disciples, he said, "Tarry ye here and watch with me." Now, we know this story. We know that his friends, they had good intentions, but they failed him. They didn't stay awake. They didn't watch. They didn't pray. And Jesus, and we know this too, Jesus has invited his three closest disciples, Peter, James, and John. He has invited them to go a little bit farther. And he has invited them to pray. But we know that the Bible tells us that they yielded to the flesh. And they didn't pray, but they do what some of you do in church sometimes. They slept. They went to sleep. And that caused Jesus. Now remember, Jesus knows what's coming. He knows what's just a few hours away. He knows the events of the next two or three days. He knows all of those things. But he looks and he's struggling, and he looks at his disciples, and he's aware of the weakness of his disciples. And in Matthew, the 26th verse, and the latter part of the 41st verse, Jesus spoke these words: "The Spirit's willing, but the flesh is weak." The spirit is willing. The flesh is weak. Jesus gets up. He arises from prayer and he walks back to the three sleeping disciples. And finally, this is about the second time I think that this happens. And then in Matthew, the 26th chapter and the 45th verse, Jesus finally comes to the place where he just says, "Sleep on. Sleep on. Take your rest." And then Jesus turns away from them, and as he looks through the trees and the limbs and the foliage that surrounds this little garden, he's able to see that there are torches and there are people, and he can hear the clamoring of soldiers' fatigue and the armor that they may be wearing, and you can see the light of the torches and the lanterns and all of these people, and he could hear all of these things, and he knows that they're being led by one of his own, a man by the name of Judas Iscariot. He is the one that's leading this band. And then for the third time, Jesus turns back to Peter, James, and John. And in Mark, the 14th chapter and the 41st verse, Jesus spoke these words. He says, "The hour has come. The time has come. Look, the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinful men." And they arouse up and they look at Jesus in what must have been a dumbfounded look and a dumbfounded expression on their face. And Mark continues in that 42nd verse with Jesus speaking and saying, "Rise, let us be going. My betrayer, he's at hand." Now the predetermined sign, we know this because we've heard this story most of our lives, the predetermined sign that was employed by the traitor Judas to identify Jesus was just a kiss on the cheek. And it was a common greeting, and it was a greeting that Jesus had probably been greeted by hundreds, if not thousands of times in his time with these disciples. And it was very common for this particular region in the world. But when it happened this time, you see, Jesus knew not only that he had been kissed on the cheek in a very familiar greeting, but he also knew the intents, and he knew the thoughts that were on the heart of Judas. And Jesus looked at Judas, and Luke gives us what Jesus said there. And Jesus said to Judas after he kissed him on the cheek, he said, "Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss?" And as Scripture records, that those who came for Jesus that night in Mark, the 14th chapter, 46th and 47th verse, it says, "Then they laid their hands on him and took him." And one of them, that's one of Jesus' disciples, and we know this is Peter. The Bible tells us that one of them drew a sword and smote a servant of the high priest and cut off his ear. Now we know that was one of the high priest's servants by the name of Malchus. And Peter cut his ear off. Somebody said, and I don't know if this is true, it makes sense to me, but somebody said he was trying to cut his head off and Malchus jerked his head at the last minute and he just got an ear. But that's what happened in that thing. And man, this is an emotion. We can't imagine just by reading the words out of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and then John's account. If you're with us on Sunday night, we know that John's account of these stories, it comes along many years later that he writes these things down. But in whatever, we can't begin to imagine how emotion filled these events were that were happening here. We see torches that are flickering wildly, and we see the events of Peter and Malchus, and then we can hear, we have to be able to assume that when Malchus got his ear cut off, that he would have screamed. I think I would scream if somebody cut my ear off. So we have that going on. We have anguish and pain, and Malchus throws his hand up to cover that spot on the side of his head where his ear used to be. And then we can begin to see that, you can just imagine that through the clenched fingers of Malchus, the blood that begins to come from the side of his head and runs down through his fingers. And all of this is happening all in one fell swoosh, so to speak. And the Bible tells us back in Matthew's account of this very same story that old Peter, he draws back not for another ear, but he draws back for the kill. And in Matthew 26, verse 52, Jesus speaks. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword in its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Or do you think that I cannot now pray to my Father, listen to this, and he will provide me with more than 12 legions of angels?" That's a question that Jesus is asking Peter. Now, just in case we're wondering, what is a legion? A legion typically was a number somewhere between 3,000 and 6,000. So if we went on the low end of that number, and we would be reminded of a story in the Old Testament. I believe it's in 2 Kings in the 19th chapter. In that Old Testament passage of Scripture, the Bible tells us that an angel of the Lord went through the camp of a man by the name of Sennacherib. And Sennacherib had an army. And on this one occasion, on this one night, this angel of the Lord, the Bible says, killed over 185,000 Assyrian warriors. So let's park the bus just for a second. Let me tell you what Jesus was telling Peter. Jesus is telling Peter right here, he says, Peter, at my beck and call, my heavenly Father, my Father, the Creator God of the universe, he said he would send these 12 legions of angels. That would be somewhere in the neighborhood of, I don't know what the exact number would be. But that the angel that was at Jesus' disposal, it represented the ability, according to that Old Testament story of Sennacherib's army, of killing 6,666,000,000 people. You say, well, why didn't he do it, preacher? If he had this at his disposal, if he said there in Matthew 26, 53, if he could pray to the Father and he would provide him with more than 12 legions of angels, some 36,000 angels that could kill over 6 billion people, and they stand ready, why didn't he call them? Let me tell you why. Because that wouldn't have fixed the sin problem. That wouldn't have fixed the sin problem. Could it have happened? Absolutely. Could Jesus have asked his Father to send the legions of angels? Absolutely, he could have. But it wouldn't have solved the sin question. You see, the Bible tells us that his plans are not our plans. His thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways are not our ways. And I tell you this morning that God had another plan. And God's plan was it had to be carried out by the death of His darling Son, the only begotten Son of God, Jesus Christ. And Jesus realized at this point in Scripture, in Matthew's account, in Mark's account, in Luke's account, in John's account, Jesus knew that His time had not yet come. Because Jesus knew that it was just Friday, but Sunday was coming. Second place that we stop is Jesus before the Jewish authorities. And you see all the places in Scripture. Well, in the meantime, Jesus has reached down in Luke, the 22nd chapter, verse 50 and 51 tell us that Malchus' ear has been laying on the ground. And Scripture tells us that Jesus picks it up and He reattaches it and He heals him and he makes his ear all like new. Well, that just shows us this, that even on the way to His own death, that Jesus still cared about and ministered to the needs of other people. Scripture records for us in John, the 18th chapter, and the 12th and 13th verse, "Then the detachment of troops and the captain and the officers of the Jews arrested Jesus, bound Him, and they led Him away to Annas first, for he was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year." Now, Jesus is taken there, and the reason that He's being taken there is for questioning. Questioning regarding the claims that He has made that He is the Son of God. The Jewish authorities don't buy into this, so they're taking him to Annas, and who's father-in-law to Caiaphas, and they're doing that because he's made these claims that he's the Son of God. Well, in this tribunal, if you would, that it's referred to quite often, they're not interested in the truth. You usually think if we go to a court of law that those that are sitting in the place of authority, that they want to get at the truth. I tell you this morning, this tribunal, they're not interested in getting at the truth. They only have one thing on their heart and one thing on their mind. Do we all know what that is? It's murder. They want to kill Jesus. And that's the only thing they're thinking about. The Bible says in Matthew, the 27th chapter and the first verse, when morning came, all the chief priests and elders of the people plotted against Jesus, now listen to this, to put Him to death. They plotted against Jesus to put Him to death. You see, they're enraged. They're enraged by His claims. They're jealous of His popularity. They're fearful of His power. They're all of these things. So Jesus is being judged on this morning, this night. Jesus is being judged by a group of morally bankrupt spiritual leaders of this day that are more concerned with their own personal welfare than they are the truth about anything. And neither do they care what happens to this innocent man who stands before them. Scripture shows us, through all of the accounts of this wonderful story, Scripture shows us the depravity, the sinfulness, the wretchedness, the callousness of those men who were sitting in judgment of our Lord on this day. After they trump up a bunch of false charges, they pay people to say certain things that are not true. Well, after all of these things happen and they trump up these false charges, and the false charges are necessary because there has to be charges to carry out these deeds that this tribunal want to carry out. Well, the Bible refers to this group of people. It refers to them in Matthew, the 23rd chapter and the 33rd verse, as a brood of vipers. In Matthew 23, 27, they're referred to as whited sepulchres full of dead men's bones. Well, they pronounce their judgment. And the judgment they pronounce is given to us in Matthew 26, verse 66. And it is simply this: He, Jesus, is deserving of death. Then in the 67th verse, Matthew tells us that after this, after they say that he's deserving of death, Matthew tells us here, he says, then they spat in his face and beat him, and others struck him with the palms of their hands. You say, what was Jesus doing? He stood silent. He spoke not a word, but he surely could have prophesied. And one prophecy that he could have spoken, one prophecy that he could have proclaimed to the Sanhedrin court, was, fellas, you may think that you have won today. He didn't say this, but he could have. Fellas, you think you have won today, but I want you to know, it's just Friday. Sunday's coming. So the next step along their journey is Jesus goes before Pilate. And in this next scene, it takes place in Pilate's hall. And it's got to be a fairly nice case, but the authorities, they bring him to Pilate, and they're convinced, man, we have an airtight case against Jesus. The chief priest and the elders, they deliver him to Pontius Pilate, and he's kind of the Roman governor of this area and this region. And it's with Pilate. You say, why Pilate? Because it's with Pilate that the authority to put Jesus to death, that's where that comes from, is Pilate. Well, Pilate is a pompous, arrogant procurator of the region. And don't you know that he's got a lot of, I don't know what the word would be, insert whatever word's applicable for you, for anyone that would sit in judgment of Jesus. That's what Pilate does. So the charges are brought against the master. Luke, the 22nd chapter, the second verse, says this, as these are these Jewish authorities talking to Pilate. They said, we found this fellow Jesus perverting the nation and forbidding to pay taxes to Caesar, and then saying that he himself is Christ, a king. Well, Christ had never been guilty of perverting the nation. He had never been guilty of forbidding to pay taxes to Caesar, the things that were Caesar. So he had never been. But remember, none of these people are interested in the truth. They're all interesting in doing away with this man named Jesus. So they all of these pretty well involved in this picture have murder in their hearts. So John, the 18th chapter, and I believe it's the 33rd verse, the latter part of that verse, Pilate speaks to Jesus and he asks a question. He says, are you the king of the Jews? Three verses down in the 36th verse, Jesus responds by saying this. He says, my kingdom is not of this world. I'm going to tell you, that made Pilate mad. Pilate's already mad because they got him out of the bed. And now Pilate asks a question, are you indeed the king of the Jews? Jesus says, my kingdom is not of this world. So now Pilate is mad. So now he poses another question in the 37th verse of John 18. And he asks this. He said, are you indeed a king? And in that same verse, Jesus responded by saying, you are right in saying that I am a king. Man, if Pilate had known who it was that stood before him on this night, he would have trembled. He would have shaken in his boots, because what we have here in this part of this story is we have the creature presuming to judge the Creator. What we have is we have the impotent judging the omnipotent. We have the finite trying to judge the infinite. Listen, if Pilate could have called heaven, if Pilate had had a way to invite heaven into his hall on this night to hear their testimony, he would have heard from millions of angels, millions of heavenly beings, and they would have attested to the claims of Jesus Christ that he was who he said he was. Because another trip to the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, we find that heaven was present when he laid the foundations for the world, for the earth. They were eyewitnesses. The book of Psalm in Psalm 147 in the fourth verse talks about the fact that they were eyewitnesses to the fact that Jesus hung the sun and the moon and he hung them on nothing. And that passage in Psalm tells us that he counts the number of stars and he calls them all by name. So had Pilate been able to invite heaven into his hall that night, they would have said, "He is indeed a king." And he's not just a king. He's the King of Kings. And he's the Lord of Lords. And listen, I don't know what they sing in heaven, but if they had our hymnal, they would have resounded with the anthem, "All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of Lords." Pilate's wife steps in on the scene along about this time. And Pilate's wife, she knew there's something different about this man that the authorities have brought before Pilate. And in Matthew, the 27th chapter, in the 19th verse, we have this conversation. While Pilate was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent to him saying, "Pilate," I'm paraphrasing that part, "Pilate, have nothing to do with that just man. For I have suffered many things today in a dream because of him." Now men, we understand that Pilate's in a predicament. Because here he's got his wife over here saying, "You walk away from this, Pilate. You don't have anything to do with what's going on here." But then at the same time, we have all the Jewish leadership. We have all of these that if Pilate does nothing and he lets Jesus go, they're going to accuse Pilate of being an enemy of Caesar. He can't have that. They're going to, and we know that from Pilate's own admission, he makes the statement, "I find no fault in him." So Pilate's in a predicament. So in an effort to appease both sides, Pilate brings Jesus and the insurrectionist. You read all four gospel accounts and we find that Barabbas is an insurrectionist. Sometimes he's referred to as a rebel. Sometimes he's referred to as a murderer. But he brings Jesus and Barabbas before the crowd because it was a custom of the day that at Passover that they would release a prisoner. And in Pilate's mind, Pilate was thinking, as he knows his wife has said, "Don't you have anything to do with this, Pilate?" And then you got the authorities saying, "Man, if you don't do something, Pilate, we're going to do something with you." So the thought in his mind is that he says, surely this mad mob, surely they will have released to them Jesus of Nazareth rather than this insurrectionist, Barabbas. But most of us know the story well enough to know that this group of people that have murder on their mind, we know that the Bible tells us, and in one account is in Luke, the 23rd chapter, the latter part of the 18th verse, when Pilate asked, "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" The Bible says, "Release unto us." This is the cry of the crowd. "Release unto us Barabbas." Barabbas. And then Matthew, in the 27th chapter, in the 22nd verse, it's tied to the same story. Matthew tells us that after the crowd cries, "We want Barabbas to be released," that then Pilate poses this question in Matthew 27:22, but what shall I then do with Jesus, which is called Christ? Do we know what the response of the crowd was? Crucify him. Crucify him. Kill him. The Gospel of Mark presents the record of the proceedings this way in Mark the 15th chapter, beginning with the 14th verse. Then Pilate said to them, why? Why? What evil has he done? But then Mark says, but they cried out all the more, and it's that same chant, crucify him. Crucify him. So Pilate, wanting to gratify the crowd, released Barabbas, and he delivered Jesus after he had scourged him to be crucified. And then in Matthew's gospel, after this event happened, in Matthew the 27th chapter and the 24th verse, the Bible says that after this has happened and Pilate has released Barabbas and Jesus has been scourged and he has been sent to them for the events of the crucifixion, that here's what happens with Pilate. When Pilate saw that he could not prevail at all, but rather that a tumult was rising, he called for a basin of water. And he stood before that crowd and he washed his hands before the multitude. And here's what Pilate said. He said, I'm innocent of the blood. Look how he refers to Jesus. Of this just, that means not guilty, man. I am innocent of the blood of this just person. You see to it. But Pilate, it's going to take a lot more than water to wash away the responsibility of this innocent blood from your hands. Because you see, Pilate was willing to sacrifice an innocent man on the altar of his popularity and his acceptance. You can just kind of see Pilate. The crowd begins to disperse and they begin to lead Jesus away. And have you ever had something on your hands that you washed and you washed and you washed and you could still smell the smell? I can't document this with Scripture, but I just have a feeling that about this time that Pilate, maybe he washed his hands again because he still knew that there was innocent blood on his hands. And maybe he looked down there at his hands and he could see blood that wasn't there. Began to join together and form out some letters and then a sentence. And that sentence might say this, it's Friday, Pilate. Sunday's coming. Then they take Jesus to Calvary. And you see the places where that happens. And this is where the scourging, a part of the scourging takes place. And listen, all of this is one of the most brutal forms of punishment. Jesus is stripped of his clothing and his hands are tied to a post above his head. And he just kind of leans there over that post. And a Roman legionnaire takes what is called a cat of nine tails, and its strips of leather has pieces of metal and bone and balls and all of these things. And with several lashes, he would take that and he would just beat that down on the back of Jesus. And it doesn't take very long before what was the skin on your back, just as it is on mine, that the skin on Jesus' back was nothing but a bunch of ribbons, and it's laid open and it's played open and it's just hanging there. And now he has become according to Isaiah, he has become an unrecognizable human. And this went on until the prisoner's near death. And when the prisoner's near death, the Roman legionnaire can say, that's enough. Well, they finally come to the place where that happens, and enough has been enough. And so they untie Jesus, and he's allowed to slump down on that cobblestone pavement, and he lays there for a bit in his own blood from the beating that he's taken. The Bible tells us that they throw a robe across his shoulders. They take a stick and they place it in his hand to mimic a royal scepter. And they do that, and they need a crown. They don't have one, so they find from a nearby bush or a nearby tree, they get a flexible sort of a vine of somehow some sort of thorns, and they fashion it together as a crown. And we know that the Bible says that they place this on his head, and they mock him, and they laugh at him, and they strike him across the face. And finally, when all of this is done, and they begin to tire of their sadistic sport, the robe is torn from his back. And he is made to pick up the cross and begin the journey to Calvary. Along the Via Dolorosa, headed to Golgotha. Jesus tries to walk upright. But we know that the Scripture teaches us that along the way that he can't go anymore. There's one appointed to carry his cross the rest of the way, but along the way Jesus stumbles and he falls. And we just have to imagine that he's bleeding all along this journey, and the stones, the very stone, now listen to this, as I know we're getting late, but these very stones that are on the ground along this journey that Jesus is on, maybe they're some of the very stones that Jesus himself has already said that humans, if you don't cry out in honor and praise to me, the stones will do so. So as he goes along this journey, and the stones that he once said, they will cry out, praises unto me. I can only imagine that they just sigh and cry, those stones, as they're touched by the blood of Jesus. And I can only imagine that as Jesus reaches down there with his hands on some of those stones to lift himself back up to make some more of the journey, that maybe he speaks to those stones and he says, hey, it's okay, because it's just Friday. Sunday's coming. Then we go to the crucifixion. They finally arrive at Calvary, to Golgotha, the place of the skull. And they lay the cross on the ground. And quickly thereafter, Jesus is thrown down on his back, and his shoulders are against the timbers that fashion the cross, and the legionnaire, the Roman legionnaire, he begins to search in Jesus somewhere in the wrist area, the hand area, I'm not sure where it is, but he begins to feel for the depression, because that's going to be the place that they take the nail that they're going to attach his hands with, and they do that. So he finds that place, and he drives the nail through the hand, and quickly he jumps over Jesus' body and goes to the other side, and he does the same. Then the feet are placed together, and the Bible says that a nail is driven through the arch of each foot. And then we know that according to John's gospel in the 19th chapter, in the 19th verse, that a sign has been fashioned, and that sign reads, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. They lift the cross into place. It drops and hits a thud in the bottom of the hole. And through that time, we can only imagine the excruciating pain that Jesus feels in both of his hands and as well as his feet. And he pushes from time to time. He pushes himself upward in order to breathe and all of these things. And the Roman soldiers who are here in attendance, they look up at this, what they say is this so-called king. They look up here, they look up at him, and they wag their heads, and they continue to laugh at him, and they continue to make fun of him, and they continue to do all of these things at this supposed king who now hangs suspended between heaven and earth. The Jews cry out in Matthew 27, the latter part of the 40th verse. One of them says, "If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." Two verses later, others are heard to say this: "He saved others, yet himself he cannot save." I believe at this point in time that the angels in heaven look on in stunned disbelief at what has happened. He's the Creator. He's the one that the Bible calls the Lion of Judah. He is the Son of the living God. And now he is being crucified at the hands of his creation, whom God the Father says was good. Then after hours of torment, hours of agony, hours of pain, Jesus lifted his weight again. John 19:30 tells us that he makes the proclamation, "It is finished." Luke 23, verse 46, tells us that Jesus spoke these words, "Father, into thy hand I commit my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last. When this happened, pandemonium broke loose in hell. Pandemonium broke loose. Nature convulsed, the Bible tells us. The sun refused to shine. The birds refused to sing to those who had killed the Creator of the universe. The earth convulsed. Hell rejoiced. Heaven stands in stunned, shocked silence. God the Father, maybe he looks down about this time from his throne and he says, "It's all right, Satan, because you've not won, because it's still just Friday. Sunday's coming." Well, that brings us to the last part of our text. And the last part of our text this morning, in this 28th chapter, beginning with the second verse, it says this: "And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning, and his clothing was white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him, became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the women, 'Do not be afraid. I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He's not here.'" You didn't hear me. He said, "You're seeking Jesus who was crucified, but he's not here. He's risen. Just as he said, come see the place where the Lord lay." It's Sunday. Looked bad on Friday. It probably looked pretty bad on Saturday morning, Saturday afternoon, Saturday evening. But now it's Sunday. And everything changes on Sunday. You see, this man who was born in a stable, born of the Virgin Mary, raised in a carpenter shop by poor parents, his people were slaves, his friends were of a lowly lot, his chances in life, they didn't seem too good. He's expected to be a slave. But people in darkness, they saw a great light in this man, Jesus. All of the power of heaven and earth that God had invested in him. He's to die on a cross. We don't have time to go to this part of the story, but in the meantime, he descends into hell. And he conquers death, hell, and the grave. He meets the devil. You ever met the devil? Some of you think you may live with him. He met the devil. And he took the keys from him. He took the keys from him. And listen, he yielded himself to death on the cross. And he cried, "It is finished." And he slumped to die. There's a celebration going on in hell. But in the midst of the celebration, they begin to hear footprints. And it's the footprints of a living Jesus. And Satan's got to be worried and he's got to be sweating. He says, "Fellas, whatever you do, don't let Jesus, who has been buried in that tomb on Friday," he says, "don't let him ascend to the throne. Don't let him get back to heaven." But I'm telling you, I believe Jesus may well have shaken the gates of hell themselves, and he conquered them. And I'm telling you, the Bible is part of, I believe that it's part of why the Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 15:55. That Jesus spoke these words. He said, "Now, O grave, where is thy victory? And death, where is thy sting?" You see, he was once humiliated. He was once placed between two thieves and crucified. But I'm telling you this morning, he's walking in majesty. He was once crowned with thorns, but the Bible tells us that today he's crowned with glory. He was once nailed to a cross through his feet, but now the Bible tells us that his feet are as burning and polished brass. He was once hushed. His voice was once hushed in death, but now the Bible says that his voice is as the rushing of many waters. His hands were once pierced. But the Bible tells us now that they're mighty to save. His face was marred. But now it is as the sun shining in its strength. Man, to that court guard, they'll never slap Jesus again. To that Pontius Pilate, he'll never sit in judgment of Jesus again. To the Roman scourger, he'll never plow Jesus back again with a cat of nine tails. To the Roman soldier, he'll never impel his flesh with the sword again. To the Jewish skeptic, he'll never again malign the character of Jesus Christ. To the Roman Caesar, he'll never again seal a grave of Jesus. Why? Because it's Sunday. And bless God, he lives. He lives. You say, "Brother Steve, is all this a big deal?" You don't know how big of a deal this is. Remember the show Let's Make a Deal on television? They got to the last 5-10 minutes of the show and they had the big deal of the day. Carol Merrill went and stood down there in front of the curtains, and Monty Hall, he would talk about it and all those kind of things. I'm telling you this morning, it's not the big deal of the day. It's the big deal of your life. You may be like these teenagers and be 13, 14 years old. You may be 80 some odd years old, or Brother Palmer will be 97, I think it is, 98 this coming Friday. We may be there, but I'm going to tell you, nothing will happen in the life of these teenagers, and nothing has ever happened in the life of Brother Palmer, nor any of the rest of us, that's bigger than this. He lives. And today he lives so that we can live. So that we can live through him. This morning I know the hour's late. But my goodness, if we can stay overtime for a football or a basketball game, we ought to be able to stay overtime for the Word of God. He lives today. And if you're here and you've never been saved, you can have life. Because he is life. Just as he conquered death, hell, and the grave, so have we when we put our faith and trust in him. There's a number of things that I worry about. I'm not going to lie about it. There's a number of things that I sweat the details of. I'm going to tell you, I don't sweat the details of where I'm going to spend eternity. I know that's going to be in heaven. And it has nothing to do with me being a preacher or a pastor. It has everything to do with that Sunday evening about a mile from here that I asked Jesus Christ to forgive me of my sins and to save me. And He did. He will do that for you today. Let's pray. Father, speak to our hearts. Remind us, we don't live in defeat. We don't live in degradation. We don't live as prisoners. We don't live in bondage because it's Friday. It's not Friday anymore. Sunday has come. We don't live on the Friday side of the cross. We live on the Sunday side where there's victory. Lord, this morning, if there's one man, woman, boy, or girl in this congregation today, that they're still over there on the Friday side. They're still on the lost side. They're still on the in bondage side. They're still in that side where there's no victory and it's all questions. Lord, this morning, because of the finished work of Jesus at Calvary, we can step over to the Sunday side. And we can know Jesus as our personal Lord and Savior. Speak to our hearts and our lives this invitation. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing.